Profile Audio, in association with The Economist, presents Branding That Means Business, written by Matt Johnson and Tessa Misiaszek, and read by Stephanie Cannon. About the authors. Matt Johnson, PhD, is a speaker, researcher, and writer specializing in the application of psychology and neuroscience to marketing. Following his PhD in cognitive psychology from Princeton University, his work has explored the neuroscience that drives brand loyalty, experiential marketing, and consumer behavior. He is the author of the best-selling consumer psychology book, Blindsight, and as a contributor to major news outlets including Psychology Today, Forbes, and the BBC, he regularly provides expert opinion on a variety of topics related to the human side of business. He co-founded the neuromarketing firm Pop Neuro and consults with a wide array of organizations, including as an expert in residence for Nike. Matt is a professor of psychology of marketing at Holt International Business School and an instructor at Harvard University's Division of Continuing Education. Find more about his work and writing at mattjohnsonisme.com. Tessa G. Misiaszek is a speaker, writer, and professor who throughout her professional and academic experience has examined the intersection between marketing strategy and workplace culture. Tessa completed her PhD at Simmons University in Boston and taught in the Simmons School of Management and Holt International Business School for several years. She also holds a master's degree in public health and a BSc in resource economics from the University of Massachusetts Amherst. She spent nearly two decades developing human capital strategies to improve healthcare, with an emphasis on provider-patient communication. Today, Tessa is the head of research for the Korn Ferry Institute, an instructor with Harvard Division of Continuing Education, and co-founder of the Happy at Work podcast. Matt, for Marlene, Santi, and Diego. Tessa, for Braden and Max. Introduction. At the time of his arrest, he'd lived a life few could dream of. He graced the covers of magazines, married supermodels, and chummed with world leaders. Aged 40, he became the youngest vice president of General Motors. His DeLorean sports car was cemented as a cultural icon when it appeared in Back to the Future. But a career fueled by a grand vision for the future ultimately crashed and burned, punctuated with an arrest for smuggling $27 million of cocaine. Legal fees and lawsuits ultimately bankrupted him and his company. John DeLorean's insatiable fervor for the future produced the highest of highs and lowest of lows. On the one hand, his story is a Greek tragedy, a classic cautionary tale of flying too close to the sun. Few business leaders, even those who, like DeLorean, consider themselves visionary leaders, aspire to such volatility. But on the other hand, there's an element of DeLorean that is central to every business, trying to understand, predict, and shape the future. Firms and business leaders go about this in a variety of ways. Companies rich in data create algorithmic simulations of how future scenarios play out. Futurists employ complex trend analysis to project years and decades ahead. Some, like Sony co-founder Akio Morita and famed designer Diane von Furstenberg, use the services of fortune tellers. John DeLorean himself regularly consulted a psychic. With all the obsession with the future, it's worth exploring another perspective that may be even more powerful than prediction. Instead of trying to predict what will shift, it's worth asking what is most likely to remain. Over time, and especially in times of intense transformation, what stays the same? Jeff Bezos is fond of this perspective. He once remarked, "People are always asking me, what's going to change in the next 10 years? But a much more powerful question is, what's not going to change?" For Bezos, his bet was that, whatever future may come, consumers will always value convenience. It's impossible to imagine a customer saying, "I love Amazon, but I wished they'd delivered slower." It's a bet on which his brand strategy was built, and which, in hindsight, was spot on. Capitalizing on enduring elements of consumer demand can be a powerful strategy. Bezos made the bet that efficiency was going to be a constant. Nike has bet that people will always want to strive to be greater than themselves. Spotify believes that, with the right platform, people will want to stream music more than they'll want to steal it. That brands often find success orienting their strategy around a constant truism of human nature points to a greater point about branding. Much success can be found by harnessing the fundamentals of human nature. The precise character of the future is unknowable. Technology will change, geopolitics will shift, and commerce will grow in new, unforeseen ways. But whatever the future holds, humans will still be humans. That is what this book is about. Branding fundamentals built on the fundamentals of human nature. Make no mistake, this is a business book. But as we'll see, the branding world finds itself at a crossroads, and it can't afford to get by simply with the fundamentals of its own industry. In constructing this guide, we draw not only from the business literature, but also from the social sciences, psychology, sociology, and even anthropology. While the brand has a business purpose, the mechanisms that enable it to be a business asset are about connecting with human beings. This approach is not only advantageous, it's crucial. Mediocre branding is quickly becoming a thing of the past. If the brand isn't excellent, it may as well not exist. In order to understand this, we need to unpack how, specifically, brands mean business, and how, in the current era, the bar has been raised. What does it mean for branding to mean business? Clearly, a strong brand can be a tremendous asset to a company. Often, it's the most important asset. But when does a brand have this kind of influence? How does a brand mean business? Brands matter when, and only when, they matter to consumers. They're an asset to a company when, and only when, they hold meaning and carry significance within minds and lives. This is how brands mean business. But as we'll see in more detail throughout this book, the threshold for endearment has never been higher. We find ourselves in a fast-paced world of immediate gratification, where consumers can, with the touch of a few buttons, listen to any song, watch any movie, or read any article. Consumers are peppered with hyper-personalized targeting for products that can be ordered seamlessly and arrive within hours. All this value can be delivered to the consumer in the absence of a known, trusted brand. What this means for brands is that modern commerce naturally pushes consumers away from brand discrimination and towards default products. For example, if consumers don't specify Duracell batteries to their Alexa, they'll merely receive any old batteries. Consumers need to actively seek out apparel from Lululemon or Athleta or Nike instead of clicking on the personalized ads for clothing on social media. Against the swift tides of commercial inertia, brands need more magnetism than ever to draw people in. To be valued to this degree, the brand must truly carry special meaning. Put simply, the brand is either beloved or it's noise. There's immense pressure on brands, but as the saying goes, pressure creates diamonds. The brands that survive and thrive won't have got by on mediocrity. This era will, by necessity, result in some of the most incredible brands in the history of business. Excellence is no longer a bonus, it's a requisite. And there is ample opportunity for brands to define excellence and meaning in their own way. A myriad of possibilities for creating brand personalities that inspire and speak to modern consumers in all their nuance and complexity. A wealth of rich emotional spaces to construct and forge connections. In striving towards the fullest expression of their potential, the possibilities are boundless. Only the future will reveal the precise ways in which brands rise to the occasion. But in one way or another, they'll have found a way to tap into the true constant of branding, becoming meaningful in the minds and lives of consumers. This book lays out how. Branding That Means Business explores these themes through 9 chapters, organized into 3 parts. Part 1 provides our foundation, centered around the role of the brand within a business. In an era in which technology mediates consumer interactions more than ever, readers are right to question why brands are needed at all. Companies need employees, websites, and products, but why a brand? We'll explore the complex contributions of a brand in full, but the response centers around this key concept, brand meaning. Brands matter only if they matter to consumers. The impact of the brand isn't about logos, mission statements, or celebrity endorsements. If it doesn't matter in the lives and minds of consumers, it ceases to matter, full stop. Our foundation, then, is centered on understanding brand meaning, Chapter 1, how companies can establish it, and how they can cultivate it within their overall strategy, Chapter 2. And crucially, we illustrate how brands harness their foundational purpose in order to rise to the challenge presented by fast-paced, tech-driven products, Chapter 3. Now that we have brand meaning in our sights and have the tools to construct it even in a formidable, tech-driven context, we turn to the molten core of the book in Part 2, Strategy. A brand strategy is a twofold question. What do we do better, and who do we do it for? This former question is our entry point. We take a deep dive into market segmentation, Chapter 4, with a particular focus on social identity and shifting notions of group membership. In Chapter 5, we extend the conversation of identity and belonging by illustrating how brands can amplify these elements to create community, demonstrate warmth, and ultimately build loyalty. We close this section on strategy by looking at how specific brand strategies can be conceived and executed within a fragmented, decentralized, and distrustful media landscape, Chapter 6. Parts 1 and 2 cover the core areas that companies need to create, maintain, and operationalize their brand. All brands, essentially, can benefit from these insights. But the principles aren't enough. Brands also need to think creatively about how to differentiate themselves in unique ways to endear themselves to consumers. This kind of creative application simply doesn't just happen. Each of the 3 chapters in Part 3 explores a key concept that supports this kind of differentiation. In Chapter 7, we introduce the concept of social signaling, in which brands and products can implicitly communicate a consumer's values, beliefs, and personality. While familiar to the luxury industry as a means to signal status and wealth, brands in many other industries may do well to consider the possibilities. Chapter 8 examines political activism and how brands should navigate this potentially tricky but increasingly important area. We close with a chapter, Chapter 9, on the power of social norms, the unspoken codes of conduct within cultures and markets, and the impact that can have on innovating brands. This perspective, we argue, is crucial for companies to reimagine themselves and disrupt existing ways of thinking. Try as we might, a clear picture of the future is frustratingly elusive. Beyond the practical limitations, the future may be unknowable even in principle. The French thinker Simone Weil, for example, argued that the future is intrinsically unknowable since its very conception is constrained by our present-day imagination. The future is made up of the same stuff as the present. Preparing for an uncertain future, then, means going beyond trends, simulations, and soothsayers. For brands, this means understanding the key constant drivers that shape their core function, establishing brand meaning. By harnessing the constants, brands place themselves in the best position to thrive within any possible future. Ready to embrace the future of branding? Hop in the DeLorean and let's get started. Part 1. A house is not a home. If you look up the difference between the words house and home in a dictionary, the word house is defined simply as a building. A home, on the other hand, is used in a more personal and emotional way. In essence, we use the word home to describe how the place where we live has become meaningful in our lives. Memories are created at home, and home often represents a part of our life that we value because of what we experience there. It helps to define and express who we are. In this first part of the book, we explore how brands create similar meaning in the lives of customers. A product is like a house. It is a thing you purchase. But when a brand establishes meaning behind the product that connects to the consumer in that personal and emotional way, it becomes more like home. Marketing is about value creation. With the emergence of technology and a fragmented digital media landscape, brands today have an even more important role to play in differentiating companies and products from their competition and delivering greater value for the customer. In Chapter 1, we define the role that brands play in the context of marketing strategy and the type of value they can bring to a company and its products and services. We also define what brand meaning is and its critical importance in the way it is established, both with and by target customers. In Chapter 2, we explore different strategies that both small and big brands can deploy to build meaning in the minds of the consumer, using tools such as brand personality and effective two-way communication with the customer. With the domination of social media in our digital media landscape, we also discuss effective strategies to co-create brand identity with the customer in order to establish a more meaningful connection. In Chapter 3, we examine the massive impact of e-commerce platforms such as Amazon on the retail industry over the past two decades. However, with the transformation of shopping as we know it, we learn that brands play an even more critical role in the success of selling products and services online, whether via a commerce platform or through an Instagram feed. The chapter also explores how brands can enhance their connection with customers by defining an authentic core purpose that aligns with a consumer's purchase motivations. These three chapters introduce the fundamental concepts that form the bedrock of modern branding strategy. Understanding the critical nature of these elements will allow your company to form a branding strategy that not only addresses the current media and retail landscape, but also allows it to be nimble enough to evolve with its target consumers. Chapter 1. The Ultimate Dinner Guest: Generating Value Through Brand Meaning. For Mariah Carey, it's three large bowls filled with green-only M&Ms. For Drake, it's a bathroom stocked with nothing but peppermint soaps and Nivea chapsticks. For Kanye, a slushy maker filled with precisely equal parts Coca-Cola, ice, and Hennessy. You think you know what picky is until you're a hotel manager with a celebrity staying in your luxury suite. The particularity of the demands knows no end. There's a lot to examine about these requests and what it says about celebrity culture and stardom. But what's most fascinating is how often these requests require a very specific brand. No substitutes. It's not enough to have one's room adorned with 50 vanilla-scented candles. They must be Jo Malone-scented candles. It isn't enough to have a fridge stocked full of pre-packaged lunches. They must be Lunchables. It's not enough to have a cola and cognac slushy. It must be Coca-Cola and Hennessy. When you can have any item in the world, the brand matters just as much as anything else. While these types of demands are extreme, they provide a window into the potency of brands and how they inform the preferences and practices of the everyday consumer. Brand effects like these are not by any means limited to celebrities. From the perspective of the company, a strong brand can impact all aspects of your business in a positive way. It drives consumer demand, reinforces financial value, and aligns corporate values with the social values of its markets. In many instances, powerful brands can directly impact how consumers experience the company's products. We believe, then, that brands can add immense value to the organization. But what about the brand is actually valuable? How can a brand build competitive advantage? A cool logo? A memorable motto? Provocative adverts? These are the tools a brand uses, but they aren't what makes a brand valuable. Put simply, brands matter when and only when they matter to consumers. The value of a brand comes from the meaning it has to consumers. The specific way that brand matters to its consumers is its brand meaning. Ultimately, then, brands are distinguished by what they signify. People don't merely love the Nike swoosh. They love what it means to them. Athleticism, aspiration, and excellence. To its fans, Evian isn't just another commodity water. It's a feeling of health and purity. Drake isn't drawn to Nivea merely because of its sleek packaging, but because it has come to signify calm, cool, and confidence right before a big show. At their best, brands aren't just a familiar logo or design. They carve out a special place in the minds and lives of their consumers. Let's consider, too, that last word, consumers. People who buy things are certainly consumers, but we really should be describing them as humans. Consumers are humans who buy stuff they want and need. Brands matter when and only when they matter to humans. This may seem like a minor revision, but the shift in perspective is important. When a company forges a connection through a brand, this isn't with a faceless mass of economic entities. It's with a group of three-dimensional humans who have needs, wants, and desires, whose behaviors are influenced by their experiences, context, and a complex web of social relationships, and who have aspirations not just for themselves, but for society as a whole. Establishing brand meaning is about entering this space. And to do so, brands need to think how they can explore how best to meet their consumers' human needs more generally. As we'll see, this also means addressing broader societal aspirations and embodying a broader purpose that goes far beyond the utility of the products. This book will focus on how brands, using a comprehensive set of tools, can strive to create brand meaning. But first, we need to understand a deeper question. Why bother? The organization has offices, employees, products, and customer service, so why focus so much on brand? What does a brand do in an organization that no other asset can do? To understand the true impact of a brand and the value it brings, we first need to gain an understanding of its place within the company. Understanding product value versus brand value. All marketers share the same general goal: generate and deliver value to the customer. For some, this is done via a service, for others, a product. Either way, a company must provide something to someone who's willing to pay for it. If a business can't deliver something valuable, it's time to pack up and go home. Forget branding, forget marketing, forget employees. A business that can't deliver value is like a chef who can't cook. Businesses deliver value in many ways. Products are the most direct, concrete means to do so. They come in all shapes and sizes. Some products are experiential, e.g. a resort. Others are physical, e.g. shoes. Others still are a platform that connects the consumer to something they need, e.g. Facebook, Airbnb, or Amazon. There's never been a better time for products. Their time has come. Because of the exponential growth of technology, companies, big and small, are generating new products with greater ease than ever before. It's never been easier to deliver value directly to the consumer. Most readers will no doubt be familiar with the digital revolution of the 2000s. But it's worth reflecting on its impact on the role of brands. Consider the transformation of the music industry. It used to be that record labels could actually control the supply of music in the market by restricting the physical production of CDs, and yes, for the Gen X readers, tapes. But with Napster, Pirate Bay, and the proliferation of illegal downloading, music quickly became fully digital. And every digital product is ultimately non-rivalrous. The companies that were successful in music, such as Spotify and Pandora, didn't create a new physical product. They created a more sophisticated digital one that simply made streaming more fun than stealing. Music is far from an anomaly. So much of what consumers need or want no longer relies on physical creation. It used to be that you needed a physical map if you wanted to get around, but that's been replaced by Google Maps, free. It used to be that you needed a stack of DVDs or VHSs if you wanted to play movies at home, but now you've got Netflix. Any piece of music that's ever been recorded? Now you've got Spotify or iTunes. We're spoiled. As the digital world has expanded, organizations have the ability to deliver value more directly than ever before. The shift has been seismic. The biggest gains in market capitalization that have been made over the past 2 decades have been largely digital. This growth is fueled by the ease with which a digital product can be created. It requires few raw materials, has the ability to iterate efficiently, and once established, it can scale far quicker than any physical product could dream of. All told, products, fueled by the democratization of technology, are booming, enabling companies to provide value in a much more direct, seamless, and expansive way than ever before. Now consider brands. With all the great products that are easy to create and that can deliver value much more directly to the consumer, why bother creating a brand at all, much less a meaningful one? Here's why. Brands can deliver something that products simply can't. In the product age, brand is a key differentiator. Products, especially digital ones, can be copied, replicated, and improved upon with relative ease. When you're competing on product value alone, there's no deeper connection with the consumer, and you're constantly having to fight for the ability to showcase value to consumers for the very first time. A strong brand, however, provides stability in the face of this transience. It's the bedrock for product offerings to rest comfortably on, and for the accumulation of value, scale, and long-term loyalty. A competitor might be able to copy an app, an e-commerce platform, or a piece of hardware, but it's much, much harder to replicate an established relationship with a market. It is brand that can truly differentiate a product from the competition and maximize its value. The unique value of the brand. A company with a great brand gets to play the game of capitalism on easy mode. Everything it does is easier, costs less, and has a greater margin for error. Interacting with a brand you admire is like getting a dinner invitation from a good friend. It's not that the food, product, doesn't matter, or that how they invite you, marketing, is irrelevant. But if the brand, like a friend, means something to you, you're much more likely to accept the invitation, enjoy the dinner regardless of the specifics, and perhaps talk about the event afterwards to everyone you see the next day. You'd also be much more open to new types of cuisine, products they might be cooking up. As we'll see in Chapter 5, brands with loyal consumer bases have a much easier time expanding to new industries. Disney, for example, accumulated 80 million new subscribers within its first few weeks when it launched its new streaming service. As we will explore in subsequent chapters, there are opportunities for companies to build a brand that is meaningful to the consumer. But this doesn't happen when brands treat customers like they are simply a sales transaction. Rather, brands must interact with their customers as humans, in a way that feels like having dinner with your best friend or family. It's akin to creating memories together. We all know that experiences we share with our friends have a tremendous impact on how we experience our lives, as their influence on our perspective is quite powerful. Meaningful brands can have the same impact. That's to say, the brand can change the consumer's experience of the product itself. In branding, this is called functional value. How brands create functional value. Building a brand is about instilling specific beliefs into the minds of customers. These beliefs are about the company and its products. When these beliefs become strong enough, they sculpt the customer experience as it relates to the performance of the product or service. That's functional value. Brands that can change, either negatively or positively, the functionality of the products. If you believe that your chosen shoe brand makes you a better basketball player, who's to say that it doesn't? Beliefs can manifest that improvement in one's ability. The same goes for nearly every product with a strong brand. Expensive cosmetic brands spend millions to associate their brand with beauty, because if the buyer believes it to be true, they feel more confident when wearing the makeup. Expensive luxury clothing brands, synonymous with style and coolness, create similar feelings in the people who wear them. Ultimately, brands matter because beliefs matter. Consider the case of Coca-Cola. It's the number one food and beverage brand in the world, and the number six brand in the world overall, behind tech titans Apple, Google, Amazon, Microsoft, and Samsung. It has almost universal brand recognition, and the vast majority of the global population has experienced the taste of Coke. Almost no other brand in the history of the world can say that about its product. Andy Warhol famously said, "America started the tradition where the richest consumers buy essentially the same things as the poorest. You can be watching TV and see Coca-Cola, and you can know that the president drinks Coke. Liz Taylor drinks Coke, and just think, you can drink Coke too." It is a brand that democratized the food industry. Perhaps most fascinatingly, Coca-Cola's branding has a deep impact on how we perceive its taste. And Coke is one of those unique brands in which the contribution of its brand equity to the product experience can be directly measured. This was made possible by the Pepsi Challenge. Launched in 1975, the Pepsi Challenge was a long-running marketing campaign sponsored by Pepsi. The inspiration came from its marketing team's anecdotal observation that when people didn't know they were drinking Pepsi, they actually preferred it over Coke. Pepsi's team put this claim to the test using rigorous standards. All trials were randomized, run double-blind, and carried out by an independent experimental team not affiliated with the Pepsi brand. This tight experimental control allowed the research team to isolate the effect of the soda taste from that of the brand. The results were clear. When tasters knew which brand they were drinking, roughly 80% preferred Coke, while only 20% preferred Pepsi. However, when brand information was withheld, blind taste testers preferred Pepsi to Coke by 53-47. Based on taste alone, Pepsi was consistently superior. An interesting extension of Pepsi's campaign came from Coke loyalists, who were confident that their soft drink was better. They were unwavering in their conviction, claiming that true Coke fans really can taste the difference. Loyalists were asked ahead of time what they liked most about Coke, and nearly all of them said the taste. Results clearly indicated, however, that they didn't really enjoy the actual soda as much as they thought. They only liked it when they thought they were drinking Coke. When they thought they were enjoying the product, they were actually enjoying the brand. Consumers weren't the only ones who were confused about the true source of value. The Coca-Cola company was taken aback by the results, which suggested that it had the inferior soda. It did what all brands do when faced with such negative consumer feedback. It tried to adjust and improve. The result? One of the biggest flops in business history. Its name? New Coke. The product was developed and launched after years of R&D, taste testing, and focus groups with consumers. The new flavor appeared to outperform both traditional Coke and Pepsi in market research taste tests. Excited by these results, Coca-Cola withdrew traditional Coke and replaced it with New Coke, rolled out as an even better improvement over the original. However, within days of this move, the brand faced backlash. Coca-Cola's corporate lines were inundated with over 1,500 calls a day, demanding the return of the original version. People scrambled to get their hands on the original version, with consumers hoarding every old soda they could find, and some even reselling them at an inflated price. There were literal riots. Protest groups sprang up across the country, such as the Society for the Preservation of the Real Thing and Old Cola Drinkers of America, which claimed to have more than 100,000 members. An iconic sign at a protest at the Coca-Cola headquarters in Atlanta read, "Our children will never know refreshment." The reverberation was so intense that New Coke was swiftly withdrawn, replaced by the original version, now branded Classic. This was another illustration of the power of the Coke brand, above and beyond, and perhaps even despite the raw utility of the product. People didn't actually love Coke for its taste. They loved it for the Classic brand. In replacing its flagship beverage, Coca-Cola overemphasized the utility of the product and underestimated the value of its brand meaning in the minds and lives of its consumers. All in all, the Pepsi challenge did reveal something important about which product consumers actually preferred. But much more emphatically, it illustrated the power of a brand rich in meaning. Functional value and product types. There's a particularly strong effect here for products that don't have a clear, measurable, objective value. Brand strategy thrives where feelings about products are highly subjective. As the examples earlier illustrate, food and beverage products are especially prone to brand effects in influencing the function of a product. This makes sense. Taste is one of our weakest and most suggestible senses, leaving plenty of room for brands to work their magic on the mind. However, brand effects are not completely limited to the taste domain. Athletic hopefuls who want to be like Mike may actually perform just a little bit better with a pair of Air Jordans, purely due to the beliefs the brand has produced by associating itself with athletic excellence. Controlled experiments have found that if you're led to believe you're using a Nike golf driver, you'll drive the ball harder and more accurately than if you are using one that is generically branded, despite the fact that the equipment itself is identical. Or consider the classic violins made by 17th century Italian luthiers Antonio Stradivari and Giuseppe Guarneri. These esteemed brands are the near unanimous choice for professional violinists and considered the creme de la creme of violin brands. In controlled studies, however, when violinists are blindfolded, they are unable to tell the difference between modern and antique instruments. When making their selection blindfolded, concert violinists regularly prefer contemporary violins instead. Even the product experts, whose very livelihood depends on their performance, still can't help falling for the brand. For products that carry more objective utility, however, functional brand value is lessened. Consider electronics. Products such as speakers, computers, and mobile phones have clear features and functionality that is objective and quantifiable. When you're shopping for a computer, you can compare things such as how much RAM it has or how many pixels make up the screen. Research here indicates that brands do still have an impact, though in less expected ways. In one experiment, participants were given a creative task that tested their ability to think outside the box and think divergently. Prior to engaging in the task, participants were...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.